You're listening to the audio production of Know Your Why by Ken Costa, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Simon Bubb.
Know Your Why, Finding and Fulfilling Your Calling in Life by Ken Costa. I dedicate this book to my wife, Fee. This book would have been impossible without her constant love and support. We journey together to find our life callings. And to Georgina, Nick, Charles, Henry, Jenny, and Claudia, who never hesitate to challenge and always encourage me. And to my late mother, Martha Faith, who prayed.
Foreword. It is estimated the average person will spend 150,000 hours at work in his or her lifetime. That translates to roughly 40% of our lives being spent at work. That's a lot. As a result, our work, our jobs, and how we spend the majority of our time are very important to God. And as it turns out, throughout the Bible, God has a lot to say about our work. Yet, many of the people I meet are either dissatisfied with their work or don't feel like they are in the right jobs. They are unsure whether they've been specifically called by God. This is an important issue, one that deserves time exploring. That's why I can't think of anyone more qualified to write about the significance of knowing your purpose than my friend Ken Costa. I first met Ken in Davos, Switzerland, at the World Economic Forum, where we were both speakers. Ken's 40 years of high-level experience as an investment banker in international finance make him a voice worth listening to when it comes to the global economy. And, as the longtime chairman of Alpha Ministries, Ken also has proven his heart for God and his people. Ken's life is a beautiful example of what can happen when we embrace God's purpose in the workplace. That is why I was very happy to endorse his first book, God at Work. His new book, Know Your Why, Finding and Fulfilling Your Calling in Life, is absolutely foundational to living a purpose-driven life. Calling is the pivot of a fulfilled Christian life. You see, God has decided that we should all engage in work. It's not a bad thing or something we should dread. Most of us work in order to meet our basic needs. We have a responsibility toward our families, and we have bills to pay. And the Bible supports this. From beginning to end, the Bible addresses how men and women should and should not approach work. Yet God has also placed in each of us a longing for meaning. We know there is more to life, and so we search for fulfillment and work that seems worthwhile. Which leads us to a larger discussion about calling and gifts and talents. How can we use the talents we have to help others and glorify God? This is particularly true of those in their 20s and 30s who have grown up in a multi-choice world which, for all its freedom, has created real uncertainty in people's life callings. Ken understands that Jesus cares deeply about our daily work. Not only that, but Jesus has uniquely gifted each one of us to make a distinct contribution. No two people are alike, and we all need each other to function. The same is true of our callings at work. Each person brings something uniquely different to the task at hand. Then why do so many people struggle to find their places in life? Many people cannot see past a difficult boss, or unemployment, or a stagnant job. And when it comes to incorporating faith at work and deriving some sort of calling out of it, there can be an even larger disconnect. If you have wrestled with these questions, I invite you to closely listen to the chapters that follow. In them, Ken Costa unwraps some of the basic ways we can begin this journey of discovery. It's practical and life-shaping, distilled from 40 years of wrestling with these issues in the workplace. Ken asserts, and I agree, that God first wants us to know that He loves us, that we are known to Him, and that, yes, He has called us. This basic reassurance, the idea of being loved, known, and called, is found throughout the Bible and is just as vital today as it was back then. Ken unpacks each of these ideas in Know Your Why. Knowing that the Lord begins by approaching His people with tremendous love adds a real layer of comfort to Ken's teaching. This is not what the world tells us, however. The world's system will encourage us to strive on our own and become the masters of our own fates. Yet what I have seen over and over again is that you can be the most talented person, have the best connections with influential people, have plenty of money at your disposal, and still not be effective or fulfilled. Why is that? Well, Jesus told us plainly in John's Gospel, in chapter 15, when he said, "I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing." The longer I live, the more I have found that statement to be true. When we allow God to be the source of our decisions in life, we have found the basis of our callings. If you're looking for a self-help book to help you become famous and make a lot of money, this is not the book for you. On the other hand, if you are serious about seeking your calling in work and in life, I wholeheartedly suggest you listen to what Ken Costa has to say. Searching after your why will require a good amount of faith and risk. It may even be uncomfortable for a while. However, if you trust the one who is calling, he will be sure to help you on your journey. Pastor Rick Warren.
Introduction. This is a book about a question. It's a question I've asked myself 1,000 times in 1,000 different ways. A question that has kept me motivated during the workday and often kept me awake during sleepless nights. It's the question most frequently asked of me by those seasoned in their faith, but also by those just beginning their Christian walks, and I've no doubt it's a question that you have asked just as frequently. It's a hopeful question and a searching question, a question that goes right to the heart of our sense of being and belonging in the world. Why am I here? And not just here on earth. Why am I here in this city? Why am I here in this job, this church, this club, this group? Why am I here? Wrapped up in this question are so many others. Where should I be going? What should I be doing? How should I be living my life? All of them fundamentally linked to the search for purpose and direction that has characterized much of my adult life. As a teenager, growing up in apartheid South Africa, as a student at Cambridge University, as a young man starting out in the City of London, and later as an experienced financial advisor, as the chairman of various charities and church initiatives, but also as a husband and father and friend, so much of my life has been a response to that question. This isn't an existential question, cried out to the empty air with no hope of reply. Instead, it's a directed question, one I've asked in expectation of an answer. It's a question I've been asking and continue to ask of God. You see, at the heart of the Christian faith is a big fat why. And that why takes the shape of a calling for us to be here, in this place and at this time. A calling for us to live out our faith and values in the rough and tumble of our everyday existence. A calling to engage with the world around us in the power and the light of Christ. The content of that calling, of that why, is set out in the Bible. It's the great commandment of Christ, to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Luke 10:27. It's the great commission to go and make disciples of all nations. Matthew 28:19. Or the great call to compassion that the book of Micah describes so beautifully. What does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Micah 6:8. The difficulty is working out how to follow that call. This common calling that applies to every Christian in every age and in every walk of life, to make known the good news of Christ to every generation, is unchanged by circumstance or culture. So what does that look like practically for each of us as individuals in our own unique situations? What does the Great Commission have to say specifically to you and me at 7:45 on a Monday morning, in a traffic jam or crammed into a commuter train on the way back to work? What does it mean for someone to act justly and love mercy while serving coffee to strangers all day. One of the great struggles of modern faith, I believe, is trying to work out what our common calling looks like in the here and now. For many years now, I've had the great privilege of mentoring men and women, often in their 20s and 30s, and these questions have confronted me more than any other. What does that Christian calling look like for me? How can I even begin to understand it or put it into practice? How could I ever play a part in God's great story? How can I come to know my why? It can be difficult to imagine that God wants to call us individually, with all our frailties and brokenness, to be His hands and feet in this needy world. The world seems so big, the problems so vast, and we can feel so insignificant. But I believe that this process of seeing the plans and purposes to which God might put us is the great adventure of faith. As Paul put it in his letter to the Ephesians, "We are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Ephesians 2:10. This book is the fruit of countless conversations and reflections through which I have tried to work out, for myself and for others, what it might look like to follow Christ's calling in the here and now. What it might look like in practice to live out a life of everyday engagement with this everyday God. As you listen, it is my hope that you will allow God to draw out your passions and hopes, your dreams and desires, that you will nurture them, grow them, build on them, and then use them to shape your life and the lives of those around you in ways you never thought possible. Be assured of this: whoever you are and wherever you are, God has great plans for you. That is part of what makes the Christian life so compelling, so hopeful, and so exciting. Our callings matter. I am passionate about helping others find true, fulfilling causes to live for. We will only be able to do this by believing that we are called with a purpose, both individually and as a community. We must believe that God has a plan, and this plan involves us. Jesus taught that we are not on earth by accident, but by a clear intention of God, for lives to be lived well and in tune with God's desires. To even begin that journey, we need to be convinced that these callings can be lived out in a practical way. This is not some personal pietistic enclosure of the righteous, but the wider call to engagement in the community around us. Yet understanding what our callings might look like is even harder for this generation than for any previous one. We live in a multi-choice world. We all face questions about where our talents and passions might be best put to use. The pressures are enormous, precisely because the choices are so wide open and often confusing. The speed of change is frightening, and yet the opportunity to be challenged and stimulated has never been greater. Since my faith came alive over 40 years ago, I have lived out this calling of Christ as best I can. Sometimes I've taken a wrong turn. Sometimes I've faced difficult choices of my own. And sometimes I've felt clearly the voice of Christ at my elbow, pushing me to take a certain route. Of course, when that voice does break through, it is life-transforming. One of the most significant moments in my Christian life occurred when, as a young man, I took some time to be alone, to pray, and to seek the Lord. I was walking along the River Thames in London, not long after I had started working in the city, the name given to London's financial district. I was feeling deeply despondent, and that question, "Why am I here?" was in the forefront of my mind. I felt a lack of purpose and direction, and I couldn't see how my work could possibly fit into God's plans. Surely, full-time ministry would be closer to God's purposes for me. The cutthroat competition of the market-driven economy seemed so far removed from the values of the kingdom. But then, as clearly and as suddenly as a dolphin breaking through the surface of the sea, Luke 24:49 burst into my head. Stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. It came from nowhere, and I knew instantly it was a word from God. It was an answer from Scripture, used in a different context, but powerful in its resonance of truth. So I stayed in the city. And through my staying, God has opened up incredible opportunities for me to shine something of His light in that place. When God shows us His purposes for our lives, He also gives us the power through His Spirit to fulfill these purposes. The point is that God comes alongside us in our callings. He works with us in relationship. Clearly, God sometimes breaks into our lives in a big way, just as He did to mine while I walked along the Thames. But other times it is much gentler, a beckoning and a whispering. Sometimes God places roadblocks if we are going in the wrong direction. And sometimes it may well be up to us to decide the way ahead. Whatever the circumstances, we have a God who walks beside us, helping us keep a sure footing when the path ahead seems uncertain. Your calling is the deep inner conviction of the Holy Spirit that the whole of your life matters to God, both where you have come from and where you are going. If you take nothing else from this book, know that God loves you more than you can imagine. He knows you better than you know yourself. And out of that place of love and knowledge, He has called you into the world to change the world with His marvelous light. You are uniquely loved, known, and called by God. This is the bedrock of your security in the world. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. John 15:16. So it was with the first disciples, and so it is with us. It is Jesus who chooses us. We do not choose Him. He gives us a clear purpose that we might bear fruit. No life calling from Jesus is barren. This fruit bearing is not a one-off spiritual high, not a temporary fix, but the development of a fruit that will last. It produces the sustainable fruit of the Spirit that matures each day throughout our lives. Remember that you will never again have these days, these relationships, these circumstances, these God-given opportunities. Making the most of life and enjoying it to the full are the challenges and promises of Jesus. I want to finish with two Bible passages that persuaded me to write this book. The first was a word that came to me in a moment of real darkness at a time when I felt hopelessly lost. All of us can go through such times of intense difficulty when our spiritual lives are hard and a kind of dark night of the soul comes upon us. Joy becomes forced rather than flowing naturally. Turbulence rather than peace is the reigning emotion. It can seem as if little will help. In this moment of darkness, a verse from Luke leapt out at me. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. Luke 22:31-32. This was an obscure passage, and I struggled at first to understand its significance. But as I read it through again, I was drawn to that last sentence. When you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. As Christians, we inevitably go through times when we feel lost, as if we are drifting along without any real purpose. We experience times of doubt, times of sifting, when we struggle to trust that God really is in control or that He has a plan for our lives. Since that moment, I have longed to strengthen those who try to make the very best of their lives. Like me, they have been sifted and spiritually assaulted, but Christ intercedes on our behalf, praying that our faith holds true And as we come through that sifting, it is Christ who becomes the cornerstone on which lives are rebuilt, careers changed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.